Hello, welcome to my talk on Low-Reynolds number turbulence models. In this talk, I will answer an important question. Why we need Low-Reynolds number turbulence models? Then I will move on to talk how we can use the Low-Reynolds number turbulence models for the near-wall modeling and how we can modify the k-omega model to a low Reynolds number model for improving the prediction of the transition from laminar to turbulent flows. The most popular two equation turbulence models, including the k-Epsilon and the k-omega models, are normally formulated for the turbulent flows of high Reynolds numbers. This means these models would be good for predicting the four turbulent flows. However, in reality, we may be frequently faced with the modeling problem in boundary layers. In the turbulent boundary layer, especially the near-wall regions in the viscous sublayer and the buffer layer, where the local Reynolds number would be small, and accordingly, the viscous effect would be more important than the Reynolds stress. In the recent development, the micro-aerial vehicles, MAVs, and unmanned aerial vehicles, UAVs, are normally operating in the low Reynolds number between 10,000 to 100,000, for which the airfoil would perform very differently from the airfoil at the high Reynolds number, where the Reynolds number would be normally larger than 1 million. The standard two equation turbulence models, including both k-Epsilon and k-Omega turbulence models, might have modeling problems, especially in modeling the turbulence boundary layer. They would fail to predict the sharp peak in the turbulent kinetic energy close to the wall, as we see in the simple pipe flow and channel flow. They fail to predict a realistic value of the additional constant C in the classic logarithmic law of the wall function, C here. And having the problem in the applications where the viscous effect must be accurately represented. For instance, the flow separation under a large adverse pressure have the difficulties in integrating through the viscous sublayer. This is especially for the k-Epsilon model. So in the next few slides, we will see how the standard k-Epsilon models can be modified to low Reynolds number turbulence models, such that it could have met some basic requirements, such as the asymptotic relations when approaching the wall boundaries, as well as other problems. Near the wall boundaries, we might have the following asymptotic relation based on the reference. The fluctuation velocity you plan would nearly proportional to y, the same as the spanwise fluctuation velocity. In the vertical direction, the fluctuation velocity would be approach to zero with y squared. Here, fx, fy, and fz would have zero time average and satisfy the Navier-Stokes equation. So based on this, we would have following important asymptotic relation. So the kinetic energy would be proportional to y squared. And the dissipation rate, epsilon, would be proportional to the fluid kinetic viscosity here. And the Reynolds suggests tau xy would be proportional to y cubic. All this when y is approaching to zero. To solve the problem for the standard k-Epsilon turbulence model, here we follow in the reference Weil Koch's book Turbulence Modeling for CFD. We take 2D steady incompressible boundary layer as an example. As such, the k-Epsilon model can be written in this form. Here, the 2D feature in the boundary layer has been applied. If we compare to the standard k-Epsilon model here, we can see in the modified k-Epsilon model, we don't solve epsilon directly. Instead, we separate epsilon as epsilon 0 plus epsilon theta, and we use the equation to solve the equation for epsilon theta. And we also see the function f1, f2, and e here. Together with the kinematic eddy viscosity for Low-Reynolds number given by nu t as this, and compared to the conventional kinematic eddy viscosity given in this form, so we can see the function f mu here. And from this formulation, we can see we have five empiric damping functions, f1, f2, f mu, epsilon 0, and e. And this would be formulated for the low Reynolds number k-Epsilon model. For complete the low Reynolds number k-Epsilon model, we define a non-dimensional parameter named as local turbulence Reynolds number, RET, given as this. From the expression, we can see this is very different formulation from what we have seen in the definition of Reynolds number. However, if we apply the Plantar's length scale based on the k-Epsilon model, the length scale would be given as this. So, if we apply this relation to the local Reynolds number, we would have the local Reynolds number in a similar form as those conventional Reynolds number. Here, k square root is the turbulent velocity. Based on the local turbulence Reynolds number, we can formulate the closure coefficient for the low Reynolds number k-Epsilon turbulence model. In 1972, Jones and Rhonda gave the closure coefficient and the damping functions f mu, f1, f2, epsilon 0, and e are this, and the closure coefficient given here. And in 1974, Rhonda and Sharma gave a slightly different formulation for the damping functions, see here, and the closure coefficient. So if we compare this to low Reynolds number k-Epsilon turbulence models, they are very similar with slight difference here and the coefficient. And by using this low Reynolds number turbulence model, we can guarantee the asymptotic relation given as this. The turbulent kinematic energy is proportional to y squared and epsilon divided by k given by this when y approaches to zero. And the Reynolds stress is roughly proportional to y cubic when y is approaching to zero. It must be noted that these two are just two examples of many low Reynolds number turbulence models. You can find more information in the reference book here and other references. Here, I will talk about the low Reynolds number turbulence model for the prediction of transition from laminar to turbulent flow. According to Weir Cox, both conventional k-Epsilon and k-Omega turbulence models predict transition at Reynolds numbers that are at least an order of magnitude too low. That is, the predicted Reynolds number at the transition is 8100. However, from the Brasher's boundary layer theory, the transition Reynolds number should be 90,000. So this is more than 10 times than the predicted Reynolds number. So from this plot, we can see that flow transition would happen somewhere here, and the transition ending here. So we have the laminar flow here, and the transition flow and the turbulent flow here. So we can see it would be very important if we can correctly predict the flow transition. For instance, when it starts and when it ends. Generally, this is still a hot topic in turbulence modeling. In this talk, we will follow Weir Cox to explain how the low Reynolds number k-Omega model could better predict the transition. Similarly to the case for the low Reynolds number k-Epsilon models, for 2D steady incompressible boundary layer, the k-Omega model can be written in this form. And if we compare this turbulence model to the standard k-Omega model, we can combine these two terms into this and these two terms into this with the parameter pk given by this and p-Omega given as this. And from this equation, we can see the transition starts when pk start to be larger than zero, and the transition ends when p omega starts to be larger than zero. So for the standard k omega model, the transition starts at Reynolds number 8100. So this compared to the Brasher's boundary layer formulation, and the transition ends at Reynolds number 12,254. So, these two Reynolds number predicted by the standard k-Omega model would be much smaller than the actual value. For the low Reynolds k-Omega model, the kinematic eddy viscosity is calculated by this expression. Here, omega TL is given by this formulation. And if we compare to the standard kinematic eddy viscosity, it is given by this. So we can see this is an important parameter for the low Reynolds k-Omega model. For completing the low Reynolds number k-Omega turbulence model, we define a local turbulence Reynolds number RET given by this formula. Again, this formula is different from the conventional Reynolds number definition. However, if we have a look at the Plantar's length scale for the k-Omega turbulence model, the length scale is given by this. So if we apply this dense scale into the expression in the local turbulence Reynolds number, we have the expression as this. This is very similar to the conventional Reynolds number. K square root is the fluctuation velocity. And based on the local turbulence Reynolds number, we can define the closure coefficient for the low Reynolds number K omega turbulence model. Here we have the expressions for alpha star, alpha, and beta star. And here we see all this local Reynolds number and some coefficient for the turbulence model. If we compare to the standard K omega turbulence model, the closure coefficients would be given in this form. In this slide, two examples will be given for the fluid transition prediction. The first example is taken from the reference 1. So by using the low Reynolds number K omega turbulence model, the prediction of the friction on a flat plate is given at this dashed line. Compared to the experiment data, for this, we can see use the low Reynolds number K omega turbulence model predict the transition from laminar to turbulence very well. See the transition area here. The second example is taken from ANSYS Fluent Theory Guide. So here, we see the transition in this area. We can see the four turbulent is dashed line, and the laminar is the black line. The squares are the experiment data. So here we employed the first grade spacing. So we can see when the maximum Y plus up to 8, all the prediction are very close to the experiment data. But for maximum Y plus equal or larger than 12, the prediction would not be good. And for the maximum Y plus equaling to 25, the transition is not predicted at all.